what black has to do here? That is the great question, because white's play is pretty much understandable, right? So white wants to play d4 to occupy the center heavily with pawns, to grab the space if it is possible, to exert pressure and so on, to complete development of the pieces. Since white will have more space, it will be not that hard task, right? There will be a lot of different squares to occupy and so on. So what black should do? We can notice that black already has some problems. For example, bishop e7 is sort of a passive one, right? So probably black has to make something to improve the position of this bishop. But well, the most important problem here is the problem of the center. Since white will exert pressure in the center, black has to decide what to do with the center, right? So here we get to the probably most important concept of the whole Ruy Lopez and this opening setup in particular. So there are usually two options, right? To give up a center, which means just to take on d4, let's say, when the pawn goes there. In many cases, it won't be that great for black. And another approach is just the opposite, right? To make everything to save the pawn on e5. And usually this second idea leads to the overprotection, so-called overprotection of the strategically important point. So in this case, e5 looks like the most important point. So black can do everything to overprotect this pawn, and this way to solve the problem of the center. By the way, the topic of the overprotection was simply greatly covered by Nimtsovich. So everyone who wants to understand the value of the overprotection in general, I just recommend to have a look on great Nimtsovich's masterpiece, My System, okay? And here, black has different choices. So knight a5 is the main one, the most popular one. Another, I would say, second popular nowadays is the Breyer system. So knight goes to b8. At first glance looks strange, but let's have a look. After d4, knight goes to d7, knight goes to d2, then bishop to b7, and we can see that black simply develops his pieces on natural squares and achieves this flexible position. So after the knight appeared on d7, it is much easier for black to play c5. It is another very important moment to understand. So in many cases, when you have a worse situation in the center, and well, here black is definitely slightly worse in the center, because white occupied central squares e4 and d4, black actually occupied only one e5, right? So in such a situation, it is a natural idea to come up with the undermining activity. Right, so it's not usually enough for a normal play just to overprotect your central pawn, right? At some point you will need to activate your pieces somehow, and the undermining of opponent's center becomes a great method to achieve your goal, right? So c5 here looks like the programmatic move, because it is exactly the undermining move, and in many cases it will change the central configuration, it will lead to different pawn structures, but definitely it is exactly what black should do at some point. And for this purpose, we can see that black simply went away with the knight from c6, where it anyway occupied not very good position, having not so many squares and doing not a great job for sure. So instead of that, the knight now occupies more flexible position, and black wants to play c5. So this helps black to play this c5. Also, this knight doesn't interfere with bishop's b7 attack of e4 and so on. So there are a lot of different advantages of having the knight exactly on d7, not on c6. So it is the Breyer variation. The system which I prefer to play in Ruy Lopez, and well, the vast majority of those who follow the Banter Blitz on Fridays with me know it, that I prefer Smyslov system, Smyslov variation, so-called. H6, for example, to start with, covering g5 square, then white plays d4, rook goes to e8. That was the idea, just preventing white's knight g5, right? Because, well, in many cases it might be annoying attacking f7, so now there is no problem with the g5 square. Then knight goes to d2, bishop goes to f8. So as you can see, this also designed to overprotect e5 pawn. So the same approach like in all main lines here, right, in Ruy Lopez. So just overprotection of the e5. And then after knight f1, bishop d7, I just show you a few moves to get to the point. Knight g3, knight a5. Bishop goes to c2, knight goes to c4. Black also comes up with the same idea. So now the knight has been maneuvered somewhere away from c6 with the idea of undermining the center at some point. So black usually prepares everything carefully. And then when there is a possibility, a good one, it is possible to play c7, c5 to undermine the center. So two basic ideas that are behind almost every line in this classic Ruy Lopez. So overprotection of the e5 and at some point undermining the center, right? So let's have a look what happened in the game. So in the game, David played knight to a5. So same idea, knight goes away to give a chance to the pawn c7 to occupy c5, and it is the start of Chigorin system. So c5 now, just even in advance to white's d4 move, white plays d4. And well, here the first move, the most popular one, is of course queen to c7. It is a classic move which was played by Chigorin himself. So it is a great idea just to support e5. Again, the same basic concept, right? Black doesn't want to give up a center, but instead overprotects e5 pawn. Moreover, when black already has the pawn on c5, at some point it is possible to take on d4 with the c pawn. C file will be open, and after that queen on c7 will be useful, just exerting pressure along this file. So I will just show you a few moves again. Nowadays, for example, this line is very popular. Bishop d7, knight goes to f1. By the way, a classic maneuver that should be learned well by any player, I think. Doesn't really matter if you play Ruy Lopez with white or black. Well, you should know this maneuver because it is a classic one, and well, it may help you in many other positions. So knight f1, the knight goes to g3 or e3, and both are interesting squares for this knight in Spanish game, because well, f5 and d5 squares are quite critical points, especially d5 after black played c5 looks very tempting to occupy with knight at some point, and so on. But f5 is also a critical square here. So knight goes to c4, b3, knight goes to b6, knight goes to e3, c4, with a very complicated play. With a very complicated play, so it doesn't relate to our today's game, but I just show you that, well, there are plenty of different lines within the Ruy Lopez. It is very interesting, and my advice for every player, just to try to play it with both colors. I believe that you will have a great experience. You will learn a lot of things. Despite it looks a bit boring, despite it looks too complicated to understand all the things, well, it worth doing. So Ruy Lopez with both colors, and let's say classic Queen's Gambit declined, also with both colors. Just my recommendation. Okay, knight goes to d7, the move which was played by David in the game against Topalov. And it is rather interesting because, well, actually black does the same, right? At first glance, there is no difference how to protect e5 pawn. In fact, this move is a bit different in the sense of the future play. So black intends to do absolutely different thing if compared to what we already saw. So instead of just overprotection of e5, you'll see what David did during this encounter. So first of all, we can see that knight d7 protects e5 pawn, and well, White has to make a decision to make a normal development move like knight d2, or to do something with the center. So of course, taking pawns on e5 or c5 leads to simplification, which gives usually white nothing here, nothing specific. So white usually has only two choices here and two concepts: to continue development, just keeping the tension in the center, or to close the center just right now with the help of d5 move. And in my opinion, d4, d5 here exactly against knight d7 looks well, very, very interesting and actually very good, because after d5, well, we can notice that this knight on a5 becomes a bit restricted, right? So no longer a possibility to come back to c6. Moreover, if black tries to, let's say, improve the position of the knight d7, so knight b6, then b3. And it is a typical play just to restrict black's knights on the queen side. After b3, let's say c4 becomes absolutely impossible for black to occupy with minor pieces for a long time. So black needs to do something to improve the situation, improve the pawn structure. And since black managed to grab some space on the queen side with pawns c5 and b5, it is possible to do. So, for example, this game was played between Sergei Zhigalko and David Anton earlier. So, in this game, David played bishop d7, then c4. And actually, after some moves, he forced white to play b4. Knight goes to b7, and now black has a chance to undermine b4 pawn. And that is exactly what happens in closed Spanish games. So it is the closed center. So typically, white tries to come up with the active plan connected with f4. Right, undermining black's e5 pawn this way and intending to activate the bishop c2, because after that the idea of e4 e5 becomes interesting. And black tries to do something active on the other side to compensate that, because usually things like f7 f5, which look very natural for instance for King's Indian defense, here simply don't work. Because, well, white's pieces are placed differently if compared to the King's Indian defense. And, well, just according to my experience, it's very hard to come up with this plan. And in many cases, white is just faster with the f4. So black simply has no time to prepare f5. Now, for example, after a3 and a5, well, black has a good chance to double the rooks along the a-file, and then to actually grab the control over second rank and so on. So in this game, white decided just to give up this pawn, this file in advance, because true, it's not possible to fight for it. Moreover, white had another plan in his mind. So knight h2, rook a8, rook f1, as I said, just preparing f4 gradually. Bishop takes, rook takes, f4, and so on. So again, we have extremely complicated position. And that is a great thing, right? So you don't have something which is definitely better for you or for your opponent. It is not even clear what the estimation of such a position. So it leads to a true fight, usually. So every Spanish game is a true fight, right? And that's why many players just choose Spanish for both colors, right? It's very hard to analyze, for example, Ruy Lopez to the very end. It's impossible, I think, at the moment. To play this, well, first of all, you need a great understanding of chess. Another thing is that playing this, you improve your understanding. That is what's really cool about Spanish. And, well, a great knowledge is actually very useful, but it is not how you can win the game in Ruy Lopez. So only knowledge won't help. So you need to think critically. You need to come up with great positional decisions during the game, and well, you need to just be inflexible, because in many cases it's not possible to play straightforwardly on one side. You need to change sides, and yeah, that's how it works. Okay, so we have to continue with the game. In the game, Topalov decided to play knight to d2, and also, it is a typical idea just to keep the tension. That is how I prefer playing with white, for example, keeping the tension and so on. But in this particular case, I would prefer d4, d5, just closing the center immediately. Moreover, it could have happened later in the game. So in many cases, it's just a good idea for white to grab the space, to restrict the knights, to make a light squared bishop a bit passive. Just imagine if the bishop goes to b7, so after d4, d5, there is nothing to do there. So the bishop should come back and so on. And instead of overprotecting e5, David decided to take on d4. Of course, it is not a novelty. It is also the line. And by the way, it is the most popular choice if black plays knight to d7. So what is going on here? What is going on here? C takes d4, knight goes to c6. Well, black actually provokes white to play d5. So first of all, black gave up the center, right? To take on d4, it is called a giving up a center, a control, so giving up pawn e5. Now, after knight c6, black actually provokes white to grab the space, so to play d5 with the tempo, which looks very promising. Because everything else, let's say knight to f1, keeping the tension, here it doesn't look very promising for white. Cd4, knight e4, knight e4, queen d4, and I guess to e5, so black has perfect position here. Of course, it is not better for black, but it's just a normal playable situation when, okay, black has the vulnerable pawn on d6, but everybody who knows something about knight earth knows perfectly that for a long, long time it is not the case, so it's not even an issue, because bishop e7 protects it perfectly. It's not usually possible to add the piece to attack this d6 pawn, so it's not a problem. There are some problems, of course, with squares like f5 and d5, but black can compensate these issues with active pieces play. So bishop can occupy b7 square or e6, it depends. I would prefer bishop b7 in this case. Then the rook will get to c8 attacking c2 bishop or something that is placed there along the c-file. c4 square is just a great square to occupy with either the knight, the rook, or the queen. Bishop e7 can be improved itself, occupying, let's say, f6 square at some point again, exerting pressure on white's position. So it's just okay for black. So instead, white, of course, plays d5. And after knight to e5, we have an interesting strategic transposition. So I call it a strategic transposition. So it's not like the opening transposition, no. Not like achieving the same position with a different order of moves, right? It's a strategic transposition. So we started with the one strategic pattern. It was typical closed Spanish pattern. Now we have something very, very similar to modern Benoni, right? So the pawn structure is exactly like in modern Benoni. And the difference, right? So pieces are placed differently. First of all, the bishop, we can notice that black's bishop is not on this diagonal h8 a1, but on e7 position. So at the moment, the bishop is not that active. It is a kind of issue, because in many modern Benoni games, everything is connected exactly to the power of this bishop, right? So it is very important to have this bishop active. It is the first moment. Another moment here, if that's black already managed to play b5. It is very important advantage if compared to modern Benoni, because in many cases there, black struggles to play b5, so white actually in time to play a4, even to play a5 to fix the pawn structure on the queen side. And well, black has much less space, right? Here b5 is already played, so at very least black has an interesting plan of just pushing pawns, because if we focus on a, b, and c files, we can notice black simply has the pawn majority there. So even in the middle game, it might be possible just to start pushing those pawns, c4, b4, a5, and so on, at some point, just even creating the passed pawn. In the endgame, it will be also very good for black, so it is sort of advantage. On the other hand, it looks like white can come up with a very, very quick play in the center. Because having this pawn structure, white's most promising plan is usually to play f4 and then e5. And here it looks like white has a perfect possibility just to take the knight on e5, then to play f4, and then to play e5. It appears it is not that simple. So if white takes on e5, which Topalov didn't do in the game, then black again takes with the knight. Of course with the knight, not with the pawn, because if black takes with the pawn, well, white will have a protected passed pawn on d5 already, a great advantage, and still more space. So knight takes on e5, and after f4, knight goes to g6. And we can see that potentially black can even obtain the advantage in development here. Because black needs to develop only light squared bishop at some point, and all the pieces will be more or less in the game, right? White needs to do much more to complete the development. But maybe it is not the most important factor here. The pawn on f4 is hanging, and it is vulnerable. That is what's much more important here. This means white doesn't have a chance to play quick e5. Right, so first the pawn should be protected. Okay, knight goes to f3, just improving position of the knight. Again, supporting this e5 and protecting f4 pawn. And here black has very nice maneuver, it is bishop to h4, using the fact that the pawn is already on h3. So here black's play is very, very concrete. So it is based on concrete features of the position. So in my opinion, if there is no vulnerability on g3, for instance, and there is no such a maneuver like bishop h4, white will be just better, because e5 looks simply inevitable. But in this concrete circumstances, black is all right. And at some point even, well, more than all right. So two options here: to take on h4, in which case queen takes h4, and again f4 is under attack, so white has no time for playing e5. Well, if white plays e5, black simply takes on f4, it is possible. And now if let's say rook goes to e4, pinning the knight, pawn takes on e5, everything is all right, so black is already up a pawn and has the advantage. And the most interesting happens if white blindly takes on d6 in this situation, because look, black already has quite a lot a lot of material focused on the king side. And no surprises, black simply wins with a direct attack now. Knight takes h3, takes, queen goes to g3, and well, queen grabs everything, and then bishop gets here to attack the queen and to be connected to the attacks, and then bishop goes to f3 and well, black wins, right? So e5 doesn't work here, white has to protect f4 somehow, and this means black has more time to solve the problem of the future e4 e5. So let's say rook goes to f1 here, looks natural, right? But the problem with that, rook goes away from the e file, and now e5 is not that supported. And here black has a good moment to play f5, since e5 is not the case, right? f5 looks like just a great idea to undermine the center, and well, to solve the problem, because if e4 pawn will be exchanged, there is no longer possibility for white to threaten with this dynamic e4, e5. There is no longer possibility for white to open up position easily, which means it will be not that easy to exploit the power of a pair of bishops, right? Black simply has no problems. Even after a4 and b4, losing the control over important c4 square, well, everything important now is going on in the center. That is what matters here. So after e5, d takes e5, f takes e5, knight takes e5, black had the extra pawn in the game, Vavrich-Svetushkin. And actually black managed to convert this advantage, although the future play was far from very simple for black and so on, because we should never forget white still has pair of bishops, and despite the material disadvantage, well, this bishop might be annoying, right? And well, there are a lot of games where white wanted to solve the problem with this f7, f5 with the help of own f5 move. So after queen h4, some players preferred to play f5. And well, this position is not that easy as one might think, right? Because at first glance, f5 looks like a serious mistake, because white gives up the plan of playing e4, e5. And that's true, because the knight simply goes to the center and occupies a really great blockading square, right? So this e5 is just perfect usually for the knight in many cases. This also makes bishop c2 very passive for a long, long time. And that is definitely the main drawbacks of f4, f5 moves. But on the other hand, we can see that now another bishop c1 is potentially very, very dangerous, since it has no counterpart. And with the help of f5, white managed to do what? To make bishop c8 completely passive at first glance, and managed to grab the space. So in many cases, the plan related to, let's say, g4, g5 will be extremely annoying, just getting closer to the king, trying to open up positions there, and so on. So what I want to say here is that this f5 move is not a mistake. It's just a double-edged decision, right? So it leads to double-edged position. So it has advantages and disadvantages, but it is surely an interesting move, because now we have the situation of a real fight, right? Who will be first? So black with his knight, great knight on e5, supporting now just perfectly black's advances on the queen side. So c4, b4, a5, a4, and this knight is just here to support all this, especially when black comes up with the c3, let's say. This knight can then jump to c4, in many cases just a typical play, right? And also controlling some important squares on king side, like f3, g4, and so on. D3 square is also interesting to occupy at some point with the knight. Or white with his attack pretty much straightforward on the king side. So there are a few games exactly in this position, so if you are interested, you can just learn it yourself. And I would strongly recommend to analyze those games, because, well, it is also very important to understand this type of positions when a square like e5 is being sacrificed when to achieve something else, right? Like advantage in space on the king side and making bishop c8 passive. So you should know that it is a typical idea for many variations of Ruy Lopez. For example, in let's say exchanged variation of Ruy Lopez, when there is of course no pawn on d5, white also plays f4, f5, gives up e5 square, but makes bishop c8 very, very poor guy, right? So that is the point here. Instead of that, Topalov played a4, which is also a move, of course. White undermines the b5 pawn. White tries to get the control of the c4 square if possible, and definitely black should not react to a4 with a b4 move or something like that, or taking on a4. It is very important to understand here. So first of all, David played bishop to b7, and just a normal developing move, preventing a takes b5. And after queen to e2, he reacted with the rook to b8 move. Because, let's say, b4 move will be not cool at all. So we can see that b5 is now under pressure. So in many cases, white just threatens to take it twice. And well, if let's say b4, which was played also in the game Krivoruchko Svetoshkin. So as you can see, Svetoshkin is kind of expert in this variation, one of the experts. So he plays it continuously. And well, another general advice, you can just notice it when you learn the opening line with the help of database, right? You can pick one GM, which you know is a good one, right? And you understand that he plays some variations continuously, which means that he works hard on the theory of those variations. So it makes sense just to focus on his games, and you will learn a lot from that. So in this game, Svetoshkin was not very good. So after b4, knight took on e5, then f4 attacking the knight, and after knight e7 just a5, another very important move fixing the weakness on a6. But what is really cool is that after rook e8, knight goes to c4, and it is really known by everybody who once played modern Benoni with black or against modern Benoni with white that this square c4 is extremely important. This square is extremely important for this pawn structure. It doesn't really matter where black's pawn is, on b4, like here, or b7, right? c4 is just a great square for the knight, because from here the knight attacks black's most vulnerable, by the way, pawn. It is a d6 one. At the same time, it controls b6 square, which is in many cases very important stuff. It protects the pawn a5, which plays a great role fixing a6 pawn and making this pawn potential weakness. And another, and well, it is one of the most important things here, this knight supports white's most aggressive e5. So giving up a control over c4 square leads to extremely bad position for black. But White Svetoshkin played this, well, maybe he overestimated his f7, f5 idea, because here it looks like very promising one, since, well, if white takes on f5, d5 remains hanging, and looks like black solves the problem of the center, and so on. But, well, Krivoruchko reacted with a very good e5 move, and after d takes e5, bishop takes f5, well, position became open, and appeared that black's weaknesses were just much more important in a sense of evaluation of the situation than, for example, a slight advantage in development and so on. So this is not great. As we can see, white just performs this breakthrough, and yeah, so bishop to e6 is now the threat, d6 is a threat, and so on. So it's a bad position. So instead of playing b4, it's much better to keep the pawn on b5. This prevents knight from occupying this extremely great position, c4. So in a game, David Anton played rook to b8, and it is a nice move. So he simply protects b5 pawn indirectly. Now, if white takes several times on b5, okay, in the very end of the variation, black will have this bishop takes d5, attacking the queen on b5. So pawn on b5 is not really under pressure, yeah? So now it looks like white needs to come up with something active on the king side or in the center, because, well, the idea of forcing black to give up the c4 square failed, right? The main plan for white is just attack in the center. So white played knight takes e5, knight took on e5 as well. A takes b5, so this move sooner or later could have been made anyway, so it doesn't change the situation much, but just a normal move, okay? This at least gives white the open a file, right? So in many cases, when you play a4 undermining the pawn on b5, you have not only the idea of just weakening some squares, right, or weakening the pawn structure, it is also sometimes possible just to open up the a file and your rook starts working from the initial position. Also not a bad result. And knight goes to f1, so white wants to continue development. Instead of playing f4, which, well, defines the position immediately, and we saw that in many cases, it is not that good, because anyway, white can't really come up with this straightforward e5 move. In many cases, it is simply impossible because of the weakening of some squares. In this particular case, well, f4, e5 is not that possible in the view of just weakened d5 pawn, right? And black can undermine the center with the help of f5 then, just like Svetushkin did in one of the games that we discussed today. Not in the last one, right? In the last one, when the knight was on c4, it wasn't that great, but in the previous one that we discussed earlier, right? So after knight f1, rook went to e8. There is the suggestion of playing f5. Well, f5 here will be just too early, and it's not clear if it will be good at all, because after let's say f5, e takes f5, for example, e takes f5, bishop takes d5. Okay, black managed to grab the central pawn, but now let's say after f4, white also has really cool pawns here. Your bishop on e7 is heading, so the knight should go to c6. Now it's possible to continue with I don't know, moves like f6 followed by queen d3, by the way, very interesting idea. So I'm not sure if it is great right away. Maybe just f6, then queen d3, attacking the bishop and pawn h7, and so on. Yeah, so not that great. So in many cases, f5 is just not a natural move for modern Benoni, by the way. So it is made only when you have absolutely concrete justification, right? If you grab the important pawn and there is no punishment for it, if you don't weaken your position too much here, it looks like you just weaken your position a lot. By the way, after f5, it is even possible to play something like f4 first, attacking the knight. Let's say knight goes here, then e takes f5, attacking the knight, and bishop on e7 is hanging. Yeah, so it's even easier than what I suggested before. So it's not that easy, like it looks like. Okay, so after knight f1, rook e8 was played, which is a good move, because e-file is semi-opened, right? The rook on this file will be very important. For two reasons. First of all, it will exert pressure on e4, and at the same time, it will stop white's e4, e5. So it is kind of a multi-purpose move. Knight goes to e3, trying to probably control c4 additionally, because black's knight on c4 could have been very nasty move in many cases, especially if white's bishop c1 goes to d2 or e3 squares, right? At the same time, we can see that white keeps an eye on f5 square, which is also typical outpost for the knight in many Spanish games. We shouldn't forget that we are already not in a true Spanish position, right? So it's more like modern Benoni, so it's a bit different. Bishop goes to f6. And we can notice that black actually made a great progress here, because bishop occupies the diagonal, which is typical for modern Benoni, dark squared bishop, right? This means black even didn't make the concession. Black didn't play g6. Because g6, well, it is in many cases a good move because it protects important squares and so on, but you should never forget that it is a concession, because it weakens absolutely concrete squares, h6, f6, and so on. So if you have a chance to occupy this diagonal without playing g6, well, usually it is much better. So here it is exactly this case, right? So bishop is on the same diagonal, which is very good to occupy, but black didn't play g6, so no weakening of the position made. Very good. And white is somewhat not developed, right? So, and it's not that easy to complete a development here. For example, if knight goes to f5, which looks like a good idea, right, to activate the knight, to exert pressure on d6, black has a good reply. It is bishop to c8. Anyway, there is nothing to do for the bishop on the diagonal a8 h1, and bishop goes to c8 to take the knight on f5, after which white will lose the advantage of his pawn structure. So the pawns f5 and f2 will be doubled, and it will be very hard for white to do something to change the situation, and the knight on e5 looks just perfect here. So after bishop c8, let's say knight goes to g3, and now when white has a chance, for example, to play knight h5 and really bother your bishop, I think only now g6 makes sense. So now g6 really needed, because knight h5 was extremely nasty idea, and at the same time, g6 is not only the prophylaxis, it is also the active move, because black prepares at some point just to play h5, h4, making this knight very, very upset somewhere on f1 or even on h1. Yeah. So we can see that g6 is made anyway, right? But only when it was really needed. So if you have a chance not to make this move, it's better not to make it. That's the point. So after bishop f6, since c4 square is already protected, Topalov decided to keep developing his pieces and played bishop to d2, because now knight c4 is not the case. At the same time, it is a concrete move, because after bishop d2, in many cases bishop a5 might be annoying, since the queen will be forced to move somewhere, and then the knight f5 will be just a tempo move in many cases again. So let's say if queen on c8, knight f5, attack in d6, and so on. So looks not very good, right? And to prevent this most annoying knight f5, David played bishop to c8. Again, as we can see, he tries not to play g6, and I find this approach very smart. Just because, well, if you have a chance to achieve the same without making concessions, it's better to do exactly this. Moreover, bishop c8 here looks like the move that black should make in any case, right? Because bishop on b7 is just very passive. So on c8, it makes much more useful work. So it controls f5, it exerts now pressure on h3. Maybe at this very moment it is not that important, but in many cases it leads to some interesting tactical motives, right? Like bishop takes h3, then knight jumps to f3. Of course, not here, but well, maybe later, right? It is also possible at some point to activate this bishop. So let's say the show goes on, right? Bishop goes to d7 at some point. When the weakening of the c4, let's say, becomes not very critical, let's say the knights are exchanged or something like that, it is possible to play b4 and then bishop is being activated through b5. So, bishop c8 could have been played anyway. Why not to make it right now, just controlling f5, so that preventing most dangerous threat, maybe, and, well, solving the problem with that this way without making your position any weaker after g6. Very nice, in my opinion. So bishop goes to a5, queen goes to e7. So now we can see how important it was to control f5 square. And, bishop goes to c3 now. And, well, it's time to understand what to do next. So the knight on e5 looks very cool, but in fact, we can see that it is not really possible to achieve anything tangible, just having this knight on e5. Well, maybe it is the sign that it's the time to improve the position of the knight, to find other squares. At the same time, black has very good pawns on b5 and c5. So these pawns control important squares like a4, b4, c4, d4. These pawns are potentially a source of white's headache, because sooner or later black will have a chance just to start pushing those pawns, grabbing more and more space, and eventually creating the passed pawn there. And Yes, it is very annoying for white, because it looks like white simply has no normal counter play in the center. Black simply controls everything perfectly here. So for modern Benoni, white's pieces are somewhat misplaced. That is my opinion, and this makes white's position really not promising. And I could imagine the state of mind of Topalov while playing this game, because it is already clear that white didn't achieve anything here. Alright, and while playing with white, it is usually additional psychological pressure, right, during the game. So when you play with white, especially on such a high level, you somewhat obliged just to play for a win. You try to seize the opening advantage and so on, right? And when you achieve nothing, well, it's really upsetting. Okay, black played very nice move knight to g6, which was, by the way, suggested in the chat. So knight goes to g6 with two purposes. First of all, the knight easily controls f4 square here. It is very important since white's idea was to play f2 to f4, right? The knight on f4, if it occupies the square, in many cases, again, might be very, very good. Even better than on e5. At the same time, very good exchange is offered, right? So exchange of dark squared bishops. If dark squared bishops are being exchanged, and it is exactly how the one should estimate every exchange. So not only straightforwardly, like, okay, is this concrete piece good or bad? Is this one good or bad? Okay, if we exchange exactly these pieces, who benefits from it, right? No, the correct estimation of the exchange in chess is to compare the power of the pieces that are left on the board after this exchange, right? So this exchange pieces no longer matter, right? So they are away, far, far away. And only those pieces that remain on the board matter, right? And if we imagine that there are no dark squared bishops, this means that white will play with not really cool light squared bishop if compared to black's one. Because light squared bishop is limited with own pawns d5, e4, g2, h3. Same pawns limit the activity of black's light squared bishop, but in my opinion, it's in many cases, in the majority cases, much better to have such a bishop like black has here than the bishop like white has here. So it's better to be limited with opponent's pawns than to be limited with own pawns. That's the idea. And another straightforward result of the exchange of dark squared bishops here is that black will simply seize the control over all dark squares around the board. We can notice that since majority of white's pawns is placed on light squares, dark squares lack a defense, and it will be not that easy for white to improve the situation, because if after exchanging dark squared bishops, white will do something like g3 f4, this will really weaken these pawns on the king's side, and black will have chances to exploit this weakening. So we can notice that the dark squared bishops exchange favors black here. It's not true for every modern Benoni position, because once again, in the classical modern Benoni, black usually plays g6 bishop g7, right? And their exchange of dark squared bishops might be, well, both good and bad for black, right? Because it will be good in the sense of getting these advantages that we discussed for this position, but it will be bad in the sense of weakening the own king. So it depends. In this situation, since black didn't play g6, and I told you that it was very important not to do this, this exchange of bishops definitely favors black. Very nice. So, position becomes really annoying. For example, if bishop takes f6, this only improves black's position, So queen takes f6. We can notice that queen simply replaces the bishop, and since queen controls much more squares, it is even better piece on f6 than the bishop. In addition to control this diagonal h8a1, it also controls squares like h4, f4 that are also critical. For example, b3 protecting b2 pawn, knight goes to f4, queen goes to f1, and rook to e5. And I would prefer this position with black pieces in 100% of cases, and even more, because the rook is being lifted to the king side through the fifth rank. Bishop on c2 is passive. Knight on f4 is just a monster, and even bishop c8, which we discussed was not a good piece, now takes part in this potential attack, right? Because it attacks h3. And I told you that, well, in the very beginning, when the bishop went to c8, it was not very critical. Now we can see that, well, h3 is a real hook for black's pieces, is a real target. So bishop on c8 is very, very important. So this position is really cool. If rook goes to a5, let's say attacking b5 pawn, then bishop takes c3, pawn takes c3, knight goes to f4 with the tempo. And again, looks like it's better for white to go to f1. Because if queen goes to f3, which looks like a bit better position than f1 because it is a bit more active, then queen goes to f6. And there is a tactical explanation for the bad position of the queen on f3, because knight h3 is a threat. Check, and then takes the queen on f3 if white recaptures. So the king should go away somewhere to prevent this idea. And now c3 pawn is hitting, which gives black the extra pawn, and well, this advantage will be not that hard, I think, to convert, since black already has two connected best pawns on the queen side. Extremely promising, and in my opinion, just great position for black here. So queen f1 is still needed, after which, let's say, queen goes to e5. As we can see, this e5 square is not only good for the knight or the rook, for the queen it is also great. So black controls both c4 and g4 squares here. It is important, so that's white can't really bother the queen. And well, this means queen is just a great blockading piece here. So in the majority of cases, queen is considered not a great blockading piece because it is really vulnerable to opponent's attacks. So every opponent's attack literally forces the queen going away, right? Here it's not possible to attack the queen, so it becomes a great blockading piece, not worse than the knight or the rook or anything else, right? So queen goes to e5, let's say rook takes b5, bishop goes to a6, rook takes b8, bishop takes f1, rook e8, queen e8, takes on f1, and well, you might be a bit surprised by this line because black simply has an extra queen here, but it's not that easy to convert the advantage. So if white wanted really to make a draw, probably it was a good idea to play this line because, well, position is closed, not so many weaknesses, and it might be a fortress, but well, I can bet that Magnus would say that black should easily win this position because he simply doesn't believe in fortresses, but it could be, in fact. On the other hand, it is very hard to imagine Topalov playing for a draw, right? So position is still not that bad, right? Just to make a draw and, well, using all possible means for it. So it was possible, but still black has the advantage and black plays for a win here. In a game, after knight g6, Topalov played queen to f3. Of course, black took on c3 here. B takes c3, and now we can notice that c3 is potentially vulnerable, but at the same time black has to be careful because pawn b5 now is placed on the open file, right? And it might be also a good object of attack for white's pieces, let's say. So David played queen g5 here. Very good move, just activating the queen, creating some threats, at the moment maybe not that critical threats, but still, like knight to h4, knight to f4, knight to e5, all these moves might be annoying. And controlling more squares, right? So this move definitely improves his position. So in a game, white played king to h2. What is the idea? What is the idea behind this move? Well, first of all, h3 pawn, as we saw in many lines, already becomes sort of vulnerable pawn, right? It's usually a good idea just to go away from the file that queen occupies, opponent's queen occupies. Here it is also just a simple idea to support white's queen g3 move, because white still wants to come up with the f4, because it remains white's only active plan, right? So white wants to prepare this queen g3 move, maybe to force the queen away from here and then to play f4 somehow, right? So this move helps it. Queen e5 was a suggestion instead of queen g5. So yes, it was a playable move, but after queen e5, queen occupies the square, which could have been occupied with the knight. In some variations, it might be very interesting for black to have this knight e5 tempo move. By the way, when the king was on g1, this knight e5 was sort of immediate threat, because it is extremely hard for white to find a good square with the queens, because if queen goes away from the third rank, then bishop h3 is possible. If queen goes to g3, then queen takes g3, and white's pawn structure is just a mess, right? So it doesn't really matter if black attacks something with the move here in this particular case, because c3 is kind of long-term weakness, right? It's not something that we have to attack immediately, otherwise it will disappear. No, it won't disappear, it will be there. Yeah, queen e5 wasn't needed, wasn't a must for black, right? And having this resource of knight e5 looks a bit more interesting, right? But of course, it's, I do believe that queen e5 is also a playable move. So rook a7 is not that dangerous, as we will see later in this game. So queen e5 was also playable. Okay, king h2, white played here. And black reacted with the interesting move h5. So black simply starts exerting pressure on the king side. Since black is already very good on the queen side, right? So pawn majority there, control of the important squares and so on. So potentially it will be just black's side to play, no questions. And since there is no dark squared bishop anymore, it is very important to come up with the correct placement of the pawns. And in many cases, this idea of playing h5 and followed by h4 at some point looks just cool, right? Because first of all, we have a well-known pattern, right? We have bishops of the same color, right? Same colored bishops. In this case, the general advice to place your pawns on the squares of the opposite color to your bishop. So since black has light squared bishop, it is a great idea to try to occupy dark squares with pawns. This simply prevents limiting of the old bishop with the pawns, right? And in many cases, it just fixes opponent's pawns on light squares here, right? So if we play h4, we fix the pawn on h3, which means that g2 also remains there. Like our pawn d6 stops the pawn d5 on the light square, also stops pawn e4 on the light square. So this process also makes opponent's bishop potentially worse, right? And here it is also the control over g4 square, which prevents white's knight activation. But it wasn't, of course, the case, because if a knight goes to g4, we can even take it with the bishop, and our knight will be better than that bishop, which is limited with all pawns. But we will discuss this pattern a bit later. So for now, h5 looks like just a great multi-purpose move. And white continues with, let's say, the same move that was planned after king h2, I mean queen g3, then black plays queen to f6. Very smart reply. Saving the queen on the board and using the fact that queen on g3 is somewhat misplaced here. So again, a multi-purpose move, a great square to occupy, because from here, queen exerts pressure on c3. But what is more importantly, it controls all possible squares that white's queen could have occupied, especially f3, because if queen goes to f3, then queen simply takes queen, and the pawn structure becomes even worse. So let's say if rook goes to a7 here, just activating the rook. Now h4. h4, queen goes to f3. It is forced here, by the way. Now queen takes f3, g takes f3, pawn structure became simply awful. And very, very nice follow-up. So the knight goes to e5, attacking f3 pawn. It's not possible to play f4 because there will be a fork on f3, right? So knight attacks not only the pawn, but also creates a threat of a fork. And when the pawn f3 is protected, let's say with the help of king g2, black can play g5. Really cool move. Again, placing another pawn on the dark square. This time, just fixing pawn on f3, fixing this new weakness. And, well, this position becomes very, very hard for white to save, since there is no active play, except for probably creating some threats with the pair of rooks. But there are not so many weaknesses in black's camp to attack with those rooks, so only d6, but it's still a problem to get to this d6. All the squares are controlled somehow. And if we compare minor pieces here, then it's clear that black is much better, because our bishop is not self-limited. Our knight occupies great central position, already attacking f3, and there are a lot of possibilities to change the direction. Let's say knight can go back to g6, then to get to f4 and to attack h3, it depends. So simply, black is better. Another question, if it will be easy to convert this advantage. Well, not easy, but still possible. So a great demonstration of what black prepared against white's queen g3. By the way, very nice prophylaxis, right? So after king h2, the idea, main idea of white was to play queen g3, right? And instead of, well, thinking of how to prevent this move, black came up with the idea of how to use the drawback behind occupying this g3 square. Very nice idea of thinking in general, right? To identify not only advantages but also drawbacks behind every opponent's plan, every opponent's idea, and to base your prophylaxis exactly on drawbacks. So how to exploit drawbacks behind this or that opponent's plan or move, right? And at the same time, h5 is the active move, right? That's why it is so great, right? Prophylaxis is usually considered something passive, right? But no. In fact, in many cases, it's just the active. So what means here a lot is not only defense, right? But simply combining your active ideas, your active plans with fighting opponent's ideas, opponent's plans. So prophylaxis is not like defense, it's more of like thinking approach, very concrete one. And of course, top players are in general very good in a sense of prophylactic thinking. So h5, well, maybe there is a question, was it possible, let's say, to play queen e5 check, grabbing the pawn on c3? In this case, queen goes to g3, and we can see that the pawn on c3 is not that great for black to capture, because black also has a drawback, that is the pawn on d6. So if queen takes c3, then queen takes d6, and well, this starts looking very, very double-edged at very least. So black will have a pair of pawns, c5 and b5, but white will also have central pawns, so it might be very annoying. What happens if black plays queen f6? Well, in this case, we can see that we achieve the same position like in the line with h5, but with the extra tempo for white, which means that white has the time for this extremely annoying rook b1 move. And after exchange of queens, well, first of all, knight e5 is no longer that dangerous because there is no threat of the fork, so white can ignore this pawn in many cases. And what matters here is that black didn't manage to develop the bishop c8, Still, rook on b8 is not protected, hence, and white has ideas connected with, let's say, bishop to a4. So, let's say knight f4, attack in h3, white comes up with the counterattack, so bishop goes to a4, and looks like it is just an equal position, so both sides have equal chances here. So, the same position, but with the extra tempo for white, and as we can see, it is critical. That's why he played h5 here. So, instead of playing queen g3, Topalov played rook a7 immediately. So, queen g3 we already discussed. What happens after rook a7? At first glance, it looks like white just made a strange move, since black has very easy tempo defense. It is knight to e5. But after knight to e5, it is not that simple. So, queen goes to g3 now, and black no longer controls f4 square. So after queen f6 and f4, knight g6 and rook f1, white actually achieves what he wanted, this placement of pawns. Of course, it is double-edged, but, still it is much better than it was just a few moves ago. So white is again in play. Let's say after queen c3, it is possible to play e5. And if d takes e5, which is, of course, not forced, but I just want to show you the danger, then bishop takes g6. Pawn takes g6, and one of a sudden, rook takes g7. Very nice blow. So if king takes, then knight f5 check, takes, and takes on c3, and, well, already black has to prove that there is a fortress. So, it could be very, very annoying, right? So knight e5 is not a move. Instead, black played rook e7. Rook takes e7, knight takes e7, of course, with the knight, because h5 should be protected by the queen. And here, white played rook to a1. Also looks very natural, since the rook occupies the open file. And, since white doesn't have this active play in the center, connected with the f4, e5, white has to do something active at least, right? And it looks like the only chance to do something in this position, to occupy the a file, and to try to occupy the 7th rank, maybe, to create some counter threats. So knight goes to g6. Of course, knight comes back to control important f4 and e5 squares. And now, if rook goes to a7, knight goes to e5. And now it's different. Why? Because white lacks the rook on the f-file, right? So after queen g3, and it is very interesting nuance, by the way, queen f6 and f4, black has intermediate h4, attacking the queen. It was also possible in the line that we discussed before, but there it wasn't that efficient. The point here is that after queen f2, the only move, otherwise, there will be just an awful pawn structure. I mean, if queen g5 or black simply takes f4 pawn, so queen f2 looks like the only sensible move. We can notice that the queen is vulnerable, so it's not possible to take on e5, which gives black very important tempo for b4 move. And black starts very annoying play, so the passed pawn arises here on the b-file. Black can be very quick with pushing these pawns further and further. And the problem is that it's not that easy to stop it, let's say with the bishop on b3. In this case, knight will occupy very important d3 square with the tempo, f4 will be hanging, and so on. And honestly, even if d3 is not possible to occupy, black has very good knight g6 idea. Again, attacking the pawn, and there is no rook on the first rank anymore, so it's not possible to support this easily with the rook f1, which means that white will be forced to play something like f5, which weakens dark squares even more, or white will be forced to play g3, which also in many cases will lead to a disaster. All right, so it is not good, but it was probably not that bad still for white. So instead, Topalov played queen g3. Of course, queen went to f6, so black did everything to react queen g3 with his queen f6 move. And now Topalov actually made his main mistake. To be honest, it is already very hard to come up with a normal move, a sensible one, because black has very simple play, right? So sooner or later, black will just play b4. By the way, b4 is already a threat since c3 is pinned. C3 is hanging in many cases. Well, of course, maybe not immediately here because d6 is also hanging, and then rook on b8 will be attacked as well as rook on a1. So it will be kind of exchange, not very clear. But h4 is also a threat after queen f6. Just damaging the pawn structure the way we already discussed. B4, once again, I told you that already. Simply improving the position of the pieces. So black is not in a hurry. Black is not in a hurry here. So black has potentially much better minor pieces and so on. No active counterplay at all. So really bad situation. So no surprises that Topalov didn't play what actually computers suggest here. Computers suggest here just to protect everything passively, like to play knight d1 after b4, to play rook b1, just currently solving the problem of the pawn c3 pinning the pawn b4. And well, after knight f4 to do something, I don't even know what, but computer says that it is still possible to keep this position. So black definitely has the advantage, but this advantage is not that dramatic. But show me please the player who will be happy with such a position, having white pieces. Yes, I do believe that no one in the real game, all right, will base his hopes on such a position, just passively protecting every single vulnerability and waiting for the punishment. No, of course not, especially Topalov. He's extremely active player. So after queen f6, he played knight to f5 instead. And by the way, here you will see the answer to the question that was raised in the chat in the very beginning of the show, when the knight just played to e3, right? Why not knight f5 in many cases and so on? Here you will see what happens after knight f5. Black simply takes this knight, e takes f5, and after knight e5, which is, by the way, not the first computer choice, we can see what happens, actually. So bishop c2 is extremely stupid, right? It is self-limited with own pawns. It was self-limited with own pawns, but after exchange on f5, it's no longer possible for white, if black plays correctly, to change the situation. So the pawn structure looks absolutely impossible to change. So it is fixed forever, almost forever. Well, this means this bishop will be never active. And the knight is just perfect. So yeah, it's possible to kick this knight away from e5 square, but main problem for white is that this knight has a lot of other good squares to occupy. For example, f6 even. So if we change the queen and the knight, I mean, the places of the queen and the knight, it will be also quite good for black. In many cases, it will be even better to have the knight on f6 than on e5. Because d5 will be hanging, right? And actually, white has a problem. But computer suggests actually to play knight e7. So it looks very strange at first glance because e5 looks much more active. But here computer bases his evaluations and suggestions on the concrete situation. So after knight e7, it will be extremely hard for white to save the pawn. So after knight e7, in the majority of cases, black simply grabs the pawn very, very soon. That is the point. But knight e5 is like a move which probably almost every player will make somewhat automatically, because it looks so natural, right? And black's advantage looks long-term one, right? So it's definitely not the situation when black should be in a rush. So white can do very little to keep this position. So knight e5 looks just more natural. But well, if you are interested, you can then download the PGN from the folder of Training Tuesday. which I shared many times. If you don't have the link to this folder, just ask me in private message. I will give you the link, and there are much more variations covered, right? So after knight e5, what to do? So it's very hard to find a good move for white, because almost everything looks awful. Almost everything looks very passive, and so only computer actually can probably halt this position. Human being, well, it's very hard, very very hard. Rook goes to b1, that was played in the game. H4, just a great move, which was planned actually to fix white's pawns and light squares. Queen goes to f4, and now black came up with not the best decision. So g5, it looks very nice to use the fact that f5 pawn is pinned, of course. In many cases, black will have very good dynamic possibility of g4. Well, at some point, it might be even the attack against the king, the knight, and the queen. We all know that it is a great attacking tandem, right? Well, it makes sense from a practical point of view. Moreover, I can imagine that there was already the situation of the mutual time trouble, or the time trouble for some of the players, for one of the players, right? So in such a situation, of course, g5 is completely justified. Yeah, but in fact, black had a better way to convert this advantage, and it is a very nice one. So now it goes to d7 first. Very concrete move, just attacking c3 pawn, creating a threat of queen e5 with further simplification, because now the simplification what black definitely needs, the closer it is to the endgame, let's say the knight against the bishop, the easier it will be to convert the advantage, because knight will simply dominate that bishop, right? So almost every exchange, except for the exchange of this knight for that bishop, will be very very good for black. So knight to d7, let's say queen goes to d2, protecting the pawn and going away from this queen e5 threat, and now queen goes to h6, just anyway offering this exchange of queens, and it appears very good because white can't really ignore it. Let's say if pawn goes to f4, this leads to new weaknesses. So knight goes to f6, now d5 is under attack, and what is great that black has the follow-up, it is knight to h5 attacking f4 and g3. Look at this square, it is also very very weak, so this makes white's position even worse. So if after queen h6, let's say queen goes away somewhere, then queen to f4, occupying perfect position with the queen, controlling everything, attacking f2, f5, and after knight f6, it is very hard for white to find a useful move. So b5 is not hanging here, since black has queen c1 in the end of the variation. So rook b5, rook b5, queen b5, queen c1 check, and grabs the bishop c2. So from this position, queen even supports b4 if necessary, or c4, or anything. So yeah, this improves black's position really seriously. So black's power increases dramatically. And as I said, it is very hard to find a useful move for white here already. So all the pieces are very passive. Very very passive. And finally, what happens if queen takes h6? Because it looks like this simply damages black's pawn structure. Well, this damage is not that critical, because white has no access to black's pawns. What is important here is that well, after let's say g4 takes takes, black has a chance to play knight f6 attacking d5, and after c4 and b4, black achieves just the best possible pawn structure. And well, it's easily winning now, because pawn b4 is already protected past pawn, and the knight has so many different strong points that it becomes really hard to not to say the words of support to the bishop c2. Yeah, so e5, d4, c3, well, almost every square on the board is kind of great spot for the knight, and the bishop became even more passive here. So this position is strategically winning already. So yeah, the exchange of queens was just a great idea here, and it was possible to do with this maneuver, knight e7, queen h6. Moreover, the maneuver of the knight to f6 square was also very, very promising, because it was the way of the improvement of the knight attacking the pawn's most vulnerable d5 and so on. But David played g5, and this appeared really cool. So after queen e3, knight c4, queen c1, he simply started improving position move by move. Of course, c3 pawn is not hanging here because of vulnerability of the g5, right? So queen attacks g5, so black's queen takes on c3, then queen takes g5, and this may backfire actually. So instead of that, king g7 was played. And well, the only normal way to keep this position for white was actually to find king g1 move here, just going away from check on e5. After, let's say, knight to e5, the point here that queen is a bit limited, right? So it's not possible to quickly improve the position of the queen here because of this pawn on g5. And this, well, creates some problems for black to convert the advantage. After knight e5, queen d2, let's say knight e7, the same maneuver like in the previous suggestion, so the knight goes to f6. But we can see that, well, at least white has a chance to come up with some little counterplay, so to make it harder for black to convert this position. And well, again, I think that only computer has a chance to keep to hold this position. So on practice, it's very hard. So in a game, white played bishop to d3, which looked natural move, but this allowed black to come up with a great sequence of moves. So first of all, knight to e5, attacking the bishop. It's not possible to take on b5 now because of queen takes f5. Look, very subtle tactical motive. So rook on b1 is now attacked by the queen. So the bishop on b5 is pinned. It's very important. Pawn on f2 is under attack. After a natural rook b2 move, just solving both problems, right? Protecting the rook and the pawn f2. Black continues with the c4 move, simply limiting the bishop b5. So now this bishop is absolutely out of play. This also creates a threat of knight d3, right? After queen e3, let's say, it is possible to come up with g4 and direct attack on the king side. So now the knight, the queen, a couple of pawns start the attack on the king side. By the way, black's rook also has a chance to join this attack by maneuvering through a8 to a1 at some point, or a2 if white plays rook to b1. So despite the complete material equality here, black simply dominates the board and wins. Right, so pawn is invulnerable. Instead, Topalov played bishop e4, but again the same g4. So now it works very good. H takes g4, knight takes g4, check. And that was actually another reason for white to play king g1 in advance. But as I said, it is very hard to well, understand all these nuances when you're a human being, when you're under pressure, when you play a normal game against a very good player. And well, when your opponent has so many different ideas, so many different threats. So black's position was really rich. So this g5 g4 was check, followed by what happened was just yeah, one of possible ways for black to play. So king g1 and finally queen to h6. So as we can see, this simplification really matters here, and sooner or later black has to come up with a simplification to offer the exchange of queens. Now, for the same reason that we already discussed, white can't ignore this queen on this diagonal. If white wants to keep queens on the board, well, it will be even harder for him to save the game. So after queen e1, queen goes to f4, simply creating a threat of queen h2 and so on. But not only, and after g3, let's say, takes on g3, takes on g3, and queen g5, well, white's position becomes just all weaknesses, right? So all the squares are weakened, all the pawns are weakened. So in such a situation, no chances to save it. Let's say after queen c1, queen c1, rook c1, and b4. So black easily gets to opponent's weaknesses move by move. So d5 will drop, And I do believe that f5 will also drop sooner or later, and black already has a passed pawn, so yeah. Just having the normal cooperation of the king, the knight and the rook, it's not a problem to convert such a position for the player of the Anton's level, okay. So after queen h6, Topalov decided to take on h6, but after king h6, it's lost. So after king f1, king goes to g5, there is a great difference in the activity of pieces currently and potentially. So all the pawns are weakened, almost all the squares are weakened. The knight dominates the bishop in such a situation, because white's bishop, as we can see, is completely useless here. No objects of attack, I mean real objects of attack, no possibilities to be activated, nothing actually, right? And the knight has so many different squares, so many different targets, and so on. So already here Topalov resigns. Well, at least there is no text in this game according to official database. I just want to show you how it could have played. For example, after bishop d3, b4 takes, and takes with the rook. As I said before, it's a good idea for black to simplify, because the closer position to the knight against the bishop relation, the easier for black just to show the power of the knight, to dominate that bishop with the knight. So rook b4, cb4, bishop c2, king goes to f4. Here it is even easier because the king is very active. So complete domination. King e2, king e5, king f3, knight goes to f6, d5 already drops, right? After g4, takes, takes, knight takes d5, g4, f6, stopping white's pawns here. And the rest is just a conversion of extra material, right? Black already has two passed pawns, so the process of the conversion will be not that hard, since the knight in such a situation also dominates the bishop, so it is additional advantage for black. To access more instructive chess videos, subscribe to my channel.